Good morning and happy Sabbath to my church family. We want to especially give a warm welcome to our visitors, and may we all of us, visitors and members alike, may we all feel God's love as we seek His face this morning. I'm going to start with a word of prayer, and then we'll get into the message. I'm going to kneel. I'm going to ask that y'all pray for me, that the words that I speak are not mine, but may God bless me, and may I get out of the way and may He use me. We want to hear a word from Him, not from no one else. Shall we pray? Our most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, once again we say thank You for allowing us to have this time with You. I humbly ask, Lord, that You use me. I'm a simple servant, and I ask, Lord, I'm not worthy to speak to Your saints. I ask, Lord, that You put the words that You want Your saints to hear, allow them to be put in my mouth, and may we hear a word from You on high. For we ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. 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 Well, I want to thank God for His grace and mercy in our lives. How many of us have seen His grace and mercy this past week? Every hand should go up. Because if we're here today, that means we've seen His grace and mercy in our lives. We could be in many, many other places, but we're here. And I'm thankful that for each person here, may He continue to bless us. Psalms 34:3 says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together." And in Psalms 118, verse 28, it says, "Thou art my God, and I will praise Thee. Thou art my God, and I will exalt Thee." I pray this morning, this is working, yes? Okay. I pray this morning that we've all come this morning to exalt His holy name. That is the purpose of coming, to have a closer relationship with Him. So as we think about this past week, have we shared Jesus with others? And as we're sharing Jesus with others, are we letting them know of His soon return? We who confess Christ must have Christ abiding in us, and not only on His holy Sabbath day, but we are to walk with Him all week. We are to share what we know with others of this amazing love that Jesus has for us, that He came and He left heaven to redeem us, and not only us in here, not only His church family, but He came to redeem the whole world. And that's what we have to share with others, to let them know that this lovely Jesus that we worship and that He's our Savior, He's coming soon. And He wants us to be prepared for that great day. And He also wants us to prepare a people to stand on that great day. A lot of what I'm going to speak about, I looked at the Sabbath school lesson last night and into this morning. And it's kind of a little bit about the same, about this great controversy between good and evil. And that one day when Jesus comes, that controversy will be over. Amen. In Jeremiah 29:13, it says, "And ye shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all of your heart." So question. Not only here at church, But are we doing that at home? Are we doing that at work? Are we doing that when we're not here? Are we searching for him with all of our heart? Because 50% and 50% of the world means we're lost. 75% and 25% in the world, we're lost. We're not going to make it to heaven. 90% and 10% of the world, we're not going to make it to heaven. We are to seek him with all of our hearts. And this world should gradually diminish our desire, and we should focus more on him, especially as we see what's going on in the world today. We as Bible believing, and we understand the prophecies of Daniel and Revelations, we should have no doubt how soon his return is. And we know in Matthew it says no one knows the time, the hour, or the date, which is true. I can't pinpoint a day and say that's when he's coming. But we can see signs. And as we see them, we can know of his return. We are told that trouble before he comes, that trouble will not decrease but increase with each passing year. So as we get closer, there's going to be more trouble here on earth. And it's not going to get better. The trouble is going to continue to increase as we get closer and closer to that wonderful day when he comes and takes us home. Luke 21, verse 28 says, "And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh." And in Matthew 44, it says, "Be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh." So how often are we hearing of earthquakes, of tornadoes, of destruction, of fire and flood, with great loss of life and property? Are we hearing that more and more? I mean, every time we turn on the news, it seems like there's something that went on, an earthquake, a tornado, flood. And it seems like there's more and more. They're happening more and more with greater intensity. That lets us know that he's coming soon. So I pray that we, as God's people, that we see these things and we see the times that we're living in. In Matthew 24, Jesus gives us the signs that we are to see before he comes. And we're seeing those now, right? We're seeing them. Turn with me to Matthew 24. I'm going to read from we'll start with that. I'll read from verse 6 to 13. Matthew 24, starting with verse 6. And when y'all there, y'all can say amen. Okay. And it says, starting with verse 6, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See ye that ye are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nations shall rise against nations, and kingdoms against kingdoms." What is that called? War. It's called war. "And there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. All of these things are the beginning of sorrows." So when we see these things, this is the beginning of sorrows. "Then persecution comes. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you. And ye shall be hated of all nations." Why are you hated of all nations? "For my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endureth unto the end, the same shall be saved." We are to endure to the end. Can we see that iniquity abound? Can we see that there's no love? It says the love of many will grow cold. There's not too much love in this world. And we're seeing these things that he described. We're seeing them now. So we're going to have, everything is going to be like attacked towards us, those that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Eventually, you know, there's nothing that they're not attacking. They're attacking marriage, an institution that God made at creation. They're attacking the Sabbath day, another institution that God made. We're seeing those things now. But are we listening? Are we paying attention? I have two short little videos. So it talked about wars and rumors of wars. One, we should see that before Jesus comes. I'm going to read a quote in a minute. It's going to tell us how the world is just before Jesus comes, what we should expect. And then there's things that we have to prepare before Jesus comes. There's a preparatory a stage that we have to prepare for these things. Noah prepared a boat, and it took him 120 years. If he wouldn't have prepared that boat, if he wouldn't have built the boat, would have Noah and his family been saved? No. God gave him a job. You need to prepare this for what's coming. And a flood came. And only 8 people went in. The rest of the world was lost. So when Jesus comes, that group that follow the Lord and are saved, that are sealed, it's going to be a small number compared to the world population. So, Melody, can you show the clip about what happened in Illinois this past? It happened this month, but at the beginning of this month. She's going to show a short clip, and then we're going to show another one about what happened in Cuba this past month also, and then I'll continue to speak.
Other news here this afternoon, a massive fire at a chicken farm in central Illinois. Firefighters working for more than 12 hours to put out the flames at the facility in Farina after a building caught fire Wednesday evening. St. Louis 11's Mallory Thomas tells us about the loss of more than 1 million chickens.
You can still see a little bit of smoke that is coming from back behind those buildings. The general manager of the farm telling us off camera that as many as 30 fire departments coming out here to put that fire out. He says this is an absolutely devastating loss for a family-owned farm.
The pictures show flames and smoke that could be seen from miles away after a building caught fire at Farina Farms in central Illinois. Drone video shows the area almost 18 hours later of the building burned to the ground. The general manager of the farm telling us off camera 1.3 million chickens died in the fire. He says no employees were hurt, but says this is a significant loss for the family-owned business. The GM says farmers and volunteer firefighters from across the region brought in water trucks to help put the flames out. He says they're thankful for the help and that no one was hurt. In Marion County, Mallory Thomas, St. Louis 11 News.
The big news making international headlines, a nuclear-powered Russian submarine and 3 Russian ships arrived in Cuba today. What are these warships doing so close to the United States? CBS's David Martin reports tonight from the Pentagon.
Having passed just 30 miles off Florida, a 4-ship Russian flotilla pulled into Havana today, led by a warship and a submarine, both armed with guided missiles, and greeted by a 21-gun salute. While the submarine is nuclear-powered, U.S. officials say there's no indication it is carrying nuclear weapons.
We, of course, take it seriously, but these exercises don't pose a threat to the United States.
It's not the first time Russian warships have pulled into Cuba. But U.S. officials say this appears intended by Vladimir Putin as a high-profile response to the Biden administration's support for Ukraine. The frigate has been used in the past to test one of Russia's newest hypersonic missiles.
We're always constantly going to monitor any foreign vessels operating near U.S. territorial waters.
2 American destroyers plus 2 ships specially equipped with sonar for tracking the submarine, along with Navy patrol planes, even sail drones, shadowed the Russian flotilla as it made its way across the Atlantic into the Caribbean. The Russian ships are expected to remain in Havana until next week before getting underway again, perhaps for Venezuela. When they do, officials say, the U.S. Navy will start shadowing them again.
A nuclear-powered submarine in Havana evokes memories of the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis, but National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan said today there is no evidence.
Were y'all aware of that or no? No? Yes, we should be aware of things that are happening. I mean, they're right there at Cuba. I don't remember another lady mentioned that how close it is to Florida. Not far. And what they had on board, she said that it could go all the way to South Carolina. So are we seeing conflict? You know, Russia's not happy that we're helping Ukraine with their war. So we're seeing a war with Russia and Ukraine. We're seeing what's going on in the Middle East with Israel and Hamas. And then Putin sends his sub, that was a nuclear sub, along with three other ships, right to our border. We've never seen war here in the United States, on our grounds. But the Bible says that that's coming. I'm going to read a quote from Maranatha 174. I don't know if my sister has it. It may be up on the screen or not. In Maranatha 174, the prophet says, "Soon grievous troubles will arise among the nations, troubles that will not cease until Jesus comes. The wars and rumors of wars, the destruction by fire and flood, clearly say that the time of trouble, which is to increase until the end, is very near at hand. We have no time to lose. The world is stirred with the spirit of war. The prophecies of the 11th chapter of Daniel have almost reached their final fulfillment. Soon strife among the nations will break out with an intensity that we do not now anticipate. In the last scenes of this earth's history, war will rage." End of quote. But with that, we also have a blessed hope. The hope of his return to gather his bride and to take us to heaven. That's our hope. Titus 2:13 says, "Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." So our eyes are fixed on that hope. Yes, storms, we're going to go through storms before he comes. But our blessed hope is to be ready on that day when he comes, to go with him to heaven, a place that he's preparing now for us. And I pray each one of us by name is in that beautiful place when he comes. We have to stay faithful. We have to stay on this narrow path. And if we do, no matter what happens to us, we'll be there when we're going to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I pray that each one of us hear that on that day when he comes. But unfortunately, when he comes, when Jesus comes, many are going to be lost. And you think of the way the world is, and you think about those that don't believe in the Lord, that don't follow him, that don't read his word. We think about that group. But many will be lost, and many of us in this remnant church that knew the truth but were not sanctified in that truth will be lost also. The close of probation is fast approaching. We have no time, not a moment to lose. We are considered watchmen. Let us as watchmen not be found sleeping during this time of earth's history. None of us should say in our heart, "My Lord delayeth his coming." He's not delaying his coming. He's going to come on the appointed time that he has to come. All we have to do is stay faithful to him all the way to the end. The purpose of present truth is to sanctify us and to unite the flock. These are the two great purposes of present truth. Now, in the day of Pentecost, were they united? Yes. Were they sanctified? Yes. They had put all their differences among themselves aside. There was no more desire among themselves to be who should be first. They were all in one place and one accord, united in prayer. And that unity in that one accord prepared them for the early rain. Likewise, we have to have that same spirit so that we can be ready for the latter rain. That latter rain is coming. But if we're not united and we're not sanctified, then we're not prepared to receive that latter rain. And God's going to give us the power to go out. And that power is going to bring many in. But we have to be united as a flock. So there can't be no bickering and no fighting amongst us. We have to be together in one accord, united, wanting to do God's work, wanting to finish his work so that he can come. In Matthew 5:16, it says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven." Now let's go to John. I'm going to start with chapter 8. And that's where we're going to be for most of this, the rest of the sermon. So in this chapter 8, and if y'all are there, y'all can say amen. So the first story that's told in chapter 8 is about the adulterous woman that was caught in adultery. And then we all know the story that Jesus asked the young lady, "Where are your accusers?" And she looked up and there was none. And then Jesus said in verse 11, she said, "No man, Lord." And Jesus said unto her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Jesus could have done a lot. Jesus could have condemned that woman because according to Moses' law, she was caught in the act of adultery. And according to the law, they should have stoned her. But Jesus gives us an example. "Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more." So we have to forgive our brothers and sisters when they fall. We can't beat them over the head with a hammer or with a Bible and say, "You shouldn't have fell." Because we don't know the situation, how they're living or what's going on in their life. We're not here to judge. We're here to extend a hand of grace. Because that's what Jesus did to this woman. And he said, "Neither do I condemn thee." But he also said, "Don't continue in your adulterous ways. Go and sin no more." So when we run into people that may have an agenda that's not ours, that's not biblical, we're to correct them, but in a manner of love, and let them know that this path that you're following is not going to get you to heaven. Jesus doesn't want you to follow that path. I hope that we can understand that's how we should. Jesus, he's our example. He's given us an example right here. But he also wants us to turn from sin. And that's most important. And then in verse 12, it says, "What group was there?" It says, the Pharisees therefore said, so there were some Pharisees there and some religious leaders, "Thou bearest record of thyself, thy record is not true." Verse 14, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true, for I know whence I came and whither I go. But ye cannot tell whence I come and whither I go. Ye judge after the flesh, I judge no man. And yet if I judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but my Father that sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men are true. I am one that beareth witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me." And then they said unto him, see, they were trying to trick him. Because they knew who his father was, Joseph, human father. So they asked him, "Where is thy father?" And Jesus answered, "Ye neither know me nor my father. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. So these were religious leaders that were in the church, but they didn't know Jesus and they didn't know the Father. What they knew is the law. And we as Seventh-day Adventists, sometimes we uplift the law. And the law, according to Romans, is good, pure. Everything good is the law. And in John 14, it says, if you love me, keep my commandments. But do we elevate the law so much that we don't have a relationship with the lawgiver? These were religious leaders. And Jesus told them, you don't know me and you don't know my Father. I pray we don't fall into that category. We want to elevate the lawgiver, God the Father and God the Son. Because if Sister White says many in our church will not be saved, we all have the same truth. We all understand the Bible and we understand the prophetic books. So my question is, why would they not be saved? Why, if we know the truth, why would I be lost? Because it's more important to know the lawgiver, God the Father and Jesus the Son, and what he did for us. And once we know him, then we can follow the commandments. Then we can do that out of love. The people that yelled, crucify Jesus. And just before that, they said, who do you pick? And they picked Barabbas, a murderer. Free Barabbas, crucify Jesus. Who were they? They were Jews. Do you think they didn't keep the Sabbath? They all kept the Sabbath. Yet they didn't know who Jesus was. They didn't accept him as the Messiah. And they said, crucify him. But they were Sabbath keepers. And I'm not diminishing the Sabbath or any of the commandments. All 10 stand together. We all understand that the Sabbath is going to be the issue at the end. We talked about it in class this morning. We understand that. But we have to understand why we keep it. Because we have a relationship with the lawgiver. We understand who Jesus is and what he did for us. And out of that love, our love has to reflect. It's a joy to make you happy, to please you. I want to do everything I can to please the Lord. And with that, it's going to be keeping the commandments and having the faith of Jesus. But those are examples of a group of people that can have the law and not know the lawgiver. Because we all understand, we've been in the church for a long time. We know how important the Sabbath is and all the other commandments. But do we have a relationship with Christ? That's most important. Because I can follow the law on my own, but that's not going to get me to heaven. I have to do it out of love for him because of what he did for me. So let me keep reading in the story. Verse 21 says, and Jesus speaking to the crowd, then said Jesus again to them, I go my way, and you shall seek me, and you shall die in your sins. Whether I go, ye cannot come. Then said the Jews, wilt thou kill himself? Because he said, whether I go, ye cannot come. And then he said to them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for you believe not that I am he, you shall die in your sins. All of us in this room should believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then they said unto him, who art thou? And Jesus said unto them, even the same thing that I have said unto you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him, speaking of his Father. And they understand not that he spoke of them of the Father. And Jesus said unto them, verse 28, when you have lifted the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father has taught me, I speak these things. And verse 29, and he that sent me is with me. The Father had not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. I do always those things that please him. Question. Are we doing always those things that please him? And that's for each one of us to answer privately. How are we living our life? How are we spending time with him? Are we growing this relationship? Are we telling others of this beautiful sacrifice that he did for each one of us? Are we uplifting our Savior? And in verse 31, then said Jesus to the Jews, which, now there was a group there that believed on him. It says, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. If we continue in his word, we are his disciples indeed. Verse 32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Free from what? From sin. Just as God at the beginning of the chapter told that adulterous woman, go and sin no more. He doesn't want us to play with sin. And as we spend more time with him, as our relationship grows, whatever sin that we were dealing with, it becomes diminished. It becomes smaller and smaller where it's not a temptation anymore. And you don't deal with that sin no more. Because through the power, the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, that's not a temptation anymore for us. But remember, we have an enemy here on earth. And he's a deceiver. And he will do everything he can to keep each one of us out of heaven. Not one of us. He doesn't want not one of us to be in the presence of our Lord. And that's in verse 44. And he's telling them that are there, you are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of lies, or of it. And then Jesus said, and because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. When we go and share our truth with others and they believe not, they may not be followers of Christ. Some may not. We're going to allow the Holy Spirit to do its work. We're not going to convict or convert any person. But if that person is truly seeking truth, he's going to hear what we have to say. And he's going to abide and say, I want to know more. I can understand what you're saying. Teach me more. And that's how we should be with everyone. Verse 47, he that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because you are not of God, speaking to those religious leaders. And he may be speaking to us as Seventh-day Adventists, because not all of us are going to be saved. So are we truly following? Do we truly have a relationship with him? And then answered the Jews to him, verse 48, and they said to him, say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and thou hast a devil? And Jesus answered, I have not a devil, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. And I seek not my own glory. There is one that seeketh and judgeth. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keeps my sayings, he shall never see death. And then said the Jews unto him, now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets, and thou sayest, if a man keeps my saying, thou shalt never taste of death. So now they want to question him. Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Whom makest thou thyself? And Jesus said, verse 54, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honors me, of whom you say that he is your God. Yet you have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Your father Abraham. So now they're looking back into history and they're thinking about Abraham, the father of this holy nation. And they know that Jesus isn't that old. And they look and they can tell that Jesus is in his young 30s maybe, or late 20s. However old he was when the story happened, they knew that he wasn't around when Abraham. So what do they tell him? Jesus says, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. And then said the Jews unto him, thou art yet 50 years old, hast thou seen Abraham? And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. What was he telling them there? He was there, and Abraham rejoiced, and they said, their father Abraham, but they choose not to do what Abraham did. What you would do as a follower of Abraham. They didn't accept Jesus, and they didn't understand that Jesus came to do the will of his Father. And I pray we don't do that. We don't elevate anything but Jesus Christ. Because we can have many things in our heart. But the only thing that should be there is Jesus Christ and what he did for us on the cross. Many who explain the plan of salvation to others have not felt the power of the transforming grace of Christ in their life or in their character. We have to look to Jesus as a sin-pardoning Savior. He is the only center. By surrendering all to him, then and only then, can we preach Christ and him crucified? The standard Christ holds out before you is completeness in your Redeemer. As I close, I'm going to read two paragraphs from The Great Controversy, and then I'll close. And this first paragraph says, now, while our great high priest is making an atonement for us, we should seek to become perfect in Christ. Not even by thought could our Savior be brought to yield to the power of temptation. Satan finds in human hearts some point where he can gain a foothold, some sinful desire that is cherished, by means of which his temptations assert their power. But Christ declared of himself, the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me, John 14:30. Satan could not find in the Son of God that would enable him to gain a victory. He had kept his Father's commandments, and there was no sin in him that Satan could use to his advantage. This is the condition in which those must be found who shall stand in the time of trouble. It is in this life that we are to separate sin from us. Through faith in the atoning blood of Christ, our precious Savior invites us to join ourselves to him, to unite our weakness to his strength, our ignorance to his wisdom, our unworthiness to his merits. God's providence is the school in which we are to learn the meekness and lowliness of Jesus. The Lord is ever setting before us, not a way that we would choose which seems easier and pleasanter to us, but the true alms of life. It rests with us to cooperate with the agencies which heaven employs in the work of conforming our characters to the divine model. None can neglect or defer this work, but at the most fearful peril of their souls. This is our job for us to do now. In one last paragraph, it says, those who endeavor to obey all the commandments of God will be opposed and derided. They can only stand in God. In order to endure the trials before them, they must understand the will of God as revealed in His Word. They can honor Him only as they have a right conception of His character, His government, His purposes. None but those who have fortified the mind with the truths of the Bible will stand through the last great conflict. To every soul will come a searching test. Shall I obey God rather than man? The decisive hour is even now at hand. Are our feet planted on the rock of God's immutable word? Are we prepared to stand firm in the defense of the commandments of God in the faith of Jesus? That is a question for each one of us. Are we prepared to stand firm in the defense of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus? Beloved, Jesus loves us. He gave His life to redeem each one of us. And He's coming back to this earth to claim all those that have surrendered their lives to Him. When Jesus was hanging on the cross, He had each one of us by name on His mind. Yes, we're going to go through some storms before He comes, but the Lord promises to be right there with us. And praise the Lord, as long as we have breath, it is not too late to accept Jesus Christ. Anyone that is hearing my voice today that hasn't accepted the Lord, know that He is knocking on the door of your heart and asking you to open the door and let Him in. There's nothing that we can do to merit salvation. It is a free gift from God to us to set us free from the power of sin and to give us eternal life. Today is the day of salvation. Harden not your hearts and let Him be the Lord of your life. I pray this morning that if anyone hasn't given their heart to Christ, that hasn't been baptized into this denomination, that they get with me, they get with the pastor, they get with another elder, because we don't have a lot of time. We are to finish the work that He wants us to do. He's offering this free gift to everyone. All we have to do is accept it. And sometimes we've been baptized for many years, you know, 10, 20 years plus, and our love has kind of grown cold. It's time to renew that love. Like when you start seeing a young teenager or young man start seeing a young lady for the first time, all he can think about is this young lady. All he wants to do is spend time with her and and make her happy. If that's not the way we feel about Christ, it needs to be, because He's coming soon. I pray you heard the Holy Spirit speak this morning.